New Smyrna Beach may be the shark bite capital of the world, but we have never had one death here.
Welcome to another exciting episode of Fishing with Jay.
What I'd like to know more is, like, why so many shark bites? Why here as opposed to, like, Southern California's got sharks and a ton of people in the water all the time. What's going on? And it seems like, you know, maybe it's in my head, but every time I hear about shark bites, it's always connected with death. So out here, I guess, get a lot of shark bites, but not a lot of people die.
If you love the water, you'll never get bored of New Smyrna. I love New Smyrna, man. It's quiet. No, it's literally a surfing beach town, man.
Man, our inlet is just a dream.
This area is known as a good surfing area. But they have surfing contests all the time here.
Sharky, but a dream.
Sharky?
Shark bite capital of the world, come on.
Can you tell me anything about New Smyrna?
Besides the fact that it's the shark bite capital of the world?
What are you talking about?
We have the most shark bites in the United States or in the world.
We average anywhere from 20 to 40 shark bites a year.
It's kind of like a cliche, but there's something to it. Everybody calls it like the shark bite capital of the world, which there's a ton of shark bites. It happens a lot here. Like I said, it's a cliche, but I mean, it does happen a lot.
Just like a pinky toe here and there, you know, a little nibble, nothing too crazy.
What are you talking about?
Most shark bites, but not, you know, deaths or anything like that. So it's just a pinky toe.
I don't know. Lots of black tips, and sometimes they're pretty feisty, but.
Destroying our bull rib.
Oh, no, you assholes.
Oh.
I'm trying.
He's gone, man.
I'm gonna have a fish at least.
I'm sorry, son of a bitch.
Look at the freaking sharks!
Oh, man.
But here you get everything. Bonnets, spinner, any shark, anything that's in that ocean comes into here.
Ponce Inlet, where the Halifax feeds out of, is basically a buffet for them because Halifax is an estuary. So all the fish go up there, give their babies, and when low tide comes, all that water comes back out. It's all funneled right there. So the sharks are just laying in wait. And obviously that's where all the great waves are. That's why the surfers are always there.
No kidding.
Yes. Every time I paddle out, there's always at least one shark that I see.
Most of the surfers are pretty well educated on what's going on in the water. It's not probably as many of us getting bit as it is tourists, you know, stepping on one or kicking one in the knee-deep water, and then they get a bite, and then all of a sudden it's a big freak out. Another shark attack.
I think I would call them shark attacks so much as a shark bite. You know, you're paddling through a school of pogies or a school of mullet. You know, oh yeah, it's middle of summer, and the mullet are assed up, and you're paddling through it, and a shark comes through, and your hand is, you know, just happens to be there, and that's what gets bit. So I think a lot of shark bites, less than what I would consider like a quote shark attack or anything like that.
But people still go out and have a good time and have some really rad stories to tell.
I want to join the club.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too.
I want to get bit, man. Yeah. Dang it.
Oh, yeah, I know a lot of people that have gotten bit.
My buddy Johnny, he's been bit twice. He has what? One toe missing. Yeah.
Yeah, I got bit.
You got any scars from it?
Yeah.
That was.
Yeah, and then those three.
What?
Went like zap. Oh. And then it like bit, and then it like felt my bone, so then it like scraped.
How long ago was that?
A year and a half ago. 5 days later, I was surfing.
Like, I don't keep track of statistics, but, you know, say in a year, if there's, you know, 15, 20 shark bites, whatever, like, you probably hear about two or three of them. And the only reason I really hear about them, for the most part, is I got a couple of buddies on beach patrol. They're like, oh, yeah, we had a shark bite today. Most of them are super minor, not even ambulatory. It's a cut, basically. I mean, some are obviously are worse. I'm not going to downplay, you know, some people, like, it, you know, have been bit. It's been worse than that.
Sharks don't have hands. When they see something they're interested in, what are they going to do? They grab you. They realize you're not what they want to eat anyway, so they let go.
You know what, Jay? You need to meet my buddy Josh. He got bit by a shark, and it was really crazy. I can't believe he survived.
Ahoy.
Josh.
Josh, I'm Jay.
I swam down. I just thought it'd be faster to swim down and push off the bottom to come up. When I did that, it
went through my legs, and you can see some scars. I mean, it's not nothing crazy, but this was all flayed open over here. There was more, but that's all I got left, kind of. But I pretty much just got the one side. I kicked really hard as soon as it kind of got me, so it didn't really clamp. It just tore that side up a little bit. But yeah, that was it. Just happened so fast. Didn't even know. I mean, I knew I had got bit. I just, it was nothing crazy.
Still had to get stitches, but it wasn't that bad.
I've seen some really bad ones. I seen a guy one time, it was crazy. The only time I've actually seen somebody, usually people get, you know, they like fall on one or startle. Do you remember that, Erie? I was working at the factory. My buddy and I took a lunch break and we went surfing. The waves were really good. We were at 12th Street. I think we parked at 12th. We paddled out and it was pretty far out. It was probably head high, maybe a little bigger, really good surf. There's one guy out further and he was on a longboard and we were pretty deep. And there was these huge jellyfish on the beach that day. I remember seeing them. So the guy was sitting, you know, like 30 yards or more out past me. And a set came, so he went over one wave, just sitting there. And then as he went down the back of it, I couldn't see him. And he started screaming and splashing. And I was like, well, what's going on, you know? So when I went over the next wave, he was already on his belly paddling towards me, like frantic, screaming, paddling. And I said, hey, bud, you all right? You know, I thought he got stung. So I was like, jellyfish get you? And he didn't say anything. And finally, he, like, paddled right past us. And he's like, shark attack. And it got his whole calf. Like, it came up and got him right on his board. He was just sitting there. And it got his whole calf. So the waves were good, and we stayed out. Like, he had help to get in and stuff. We made sure he was okay to get in. But we stayed out for, like, another hour. And it was the sketchiest session I think I've ever had. Just laying on our boards waiting for sets to come. But when we went in, he had parked at 12th Street too, so you could see blood footprints all the way up the beach, all the way up the stairs and in the parking lot. And then a buddy that worked with us, Andy, was working. His sister was actually in the ER, and that guy walked in. I guess it was pretty bad. He got a whole calf, was just kind of hanging there. So that might have been like a bull shark or something, you know. But that's the first and only time I ever heard of somebody actually being attacked just sitting there. Usually it's, you know, startle or fall on one or something in that nature. But
all right, they're scooping up the blood. That's pretty gross. Pretty tough, man. They got to get the blood off the beach. Bruh.
There's kind of a couple ingredients to that sauce. You have the inlet here, which is good surfing, really good surfing up around the inlet. There's a ton of bait fish and there's a ton of food source. And the water's really dirty, and it stays churned up. So you have a ton of bait in dark water, a ton of surfers in the water, and a ton of sharks there to eat that bait. A perfect storm for people to get bit.
It should be crazy to catch a shark. That would be crazy. I don't even know what I'd do. I guess I'd reel it in. All right, first cast. No idea if I'm doing this right at all. We'll see. Bait's pretty gross. Makes me remember why I don't bait fish. Shit's dying so I can have fun. That's kind of weird. Ooh, the water feels good though. A little sandbar here. Okay. I think I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, but I have no idea. This is probably going to just be horrible. The worst cast ever, but I'm going to try. Uh-oh, that's a lot of water. Is that enough? Who knows? No one knows. Is that far enough? Is that far? Is that really close? Who knows? Not me. I don't know. I have no clue what's going on.
All right, day 5 or 6. Been hitting the beach in the morning by the jetty trying to get a shark. Shark bite capital of the world, they said. Come on, baby.
A lot of waiting. Way different than fly fishing. There's a lot of just kind of sitting around on the beach. Which sounds like heaven to some people. I understand people pay to do that sometimes, but I'm born for it. But I'm doing my best.
Here is the disaster. So easy, I'm trying to find a shark off the beach, man.
So listen, you need to go to Bethune.
What's Bethune?
Bethune Beach, which is named after Mary McLeod Bethune, the founder of Bethune-Cookman College in Daytona. That beach was named after her. All my life growing up, I used to go down to Bethune. I never really went to Flagler until I got a little bit older. And that's just because that's just where my family used to go. That's where we was used to going. Bethune was the first actual beach where African Americans could actually go to a public beach. So that beach is a very, very historic beach. A very sacred spot because of the fact that through the whole Jim Crow era and all of the racial segregation and all of that stuff, that was the only public beach that we could literally get in the waters.
You couldn't have even came onto the beach with me.
No, not at all. No, sir.
I mean, that's crazy, dude.
No, sir. We had a beach that we were allowed to go to, and that's about it.
They're always catching big sharks down there, and specifically at nighttime, I've always seen shark fishermen, guys specifically fishing for sharks down there. And it's pretty cool, man. It's definitely a spot that I feel like you will have a lot of success at. That's where you need to go, man. You need to try out Bethune Beach.
Yeah, sharks get the bad rap. Oh, I got attacked by a shark. Why? Well, you were in their territory. I mean, do grizzly bears get a bad rap when you go camping in the woods and they invade your tent? You're in their home. Accept the consequences.
Shark fishing is a very interesting thing. It might just be a phase for me. I have no idea. I've never fished like with bait and gear before, so it's a lot of learning. It's the first beach to allow black people on it. Nowadays, it just happens to be the shark beach. I came down here to do some shark fishing, and I ran into Dustin and Tyler, two hardcore land-based shark fishermen.
Land-based shark fishing is just that. We are shark fishing from the beach. No boats, just the right gear to be able to bring in the sharks, get them safely in and get them safely tagged and get them safely put back.
My name is Tyler, I'm an avid shark fisherman. I'm out here in New Smyrna Beach where I'm a local. I actually do the land-based shark fishing.
Captain Dustin Smith, New Smyrna Beach, Florida. And this is what I do.
Over here, we have an Akuma Makara 80 wide. It's running 1,500 yards of 130-pound post-spec hollow core braid. And it's got 150 yards of 250-pound Neo Diamond mono top shot.
Yeah, that's a big hook right there.
These are all circle hooks. You gotta apply drag and let them pull out to the side of the mouth. Setting the hook would be an oxymoron, to be honest. You're pulling the hook right out of its mouth. You know, there's no room for error. Everything's got to be perfect. You have a wrong crimp, you're not going to land the shark. It's going to find where that terminal tackle failure is at. And you have to utilize that, and you have to pay attention to your gear so you can ensure that it's safe for you to reel in without losing it and safe for the shark to not take off with a rig in its mouth, possibly killing it in the future.
So this is an 800-pound, 18-aught shark leader, 6 foot long. We've never had a shark bite through it, and the biggest we've caught on these so far is a 12-foot hammerhead.
This is the shark bite capital of the world, so the success of us hooking up tonight is pretty good. I'm yakking. I'm not flying baits out, and I'm not boating baits out. I'm not jet skiing baits out. I'm yakking. I like my rigs set perfect, and the only way that's done is by hand, and that's why I do it by hand. I still yak.
You guys put them out in the daylight.
Yeah, pretty much. You got to get them out early and then let them soak. It's better to do it in the daytime because if you do it at night, you never know what the hell is going to happen. It's going to be sketchy. Usually made for tuna, but we use them for shark.
You can send a bait too far. You can send a bait too shallow. I mean, it depends on where they're feeding. That's why more baits are better. You like to have some 200 yards. You like to have some 400 yards. And you might want to bomb some 700, 800 yards. And that's a far drop. I mean, this one tonight, maybe 600. That's a far drop. That's a good drop. It's technicals. It's a challenge daily. And it's hard work.
Hard work. And that's why I do it.
It's interesting. They've got monster, gigantic baits. I would bet one of those baits was 15 pounds of fish, full jacks, giant carcasses, and then they kayak them out there, drop one at a time, and they got a lot of rods out right now.
For bait on this one, we got a half a southern, about a 10-pound bait, on the 80 wide in the middle, about a 15 to 20-pound cow nose torso on it, and then on the end, we have an entire cow nose, about 7-8 pounds, about a foot and a half wide.
It is a lot of time, it is a lot of money, it's a lot of effort, but it's worth it in the end.
When you beach that beast, it is worth it at the end.
You worked hard for it. But I do deep drops in New Smyrna because this is shark bite capital of the world. There's a lot of sharks here.
We're not trying to bring them in closer. They're already right here. Right off this ledge right here, you step off that, you're going down 5 feet right there.
A good friend of mine that I grew up with taught me everything I know about fishing, and then he's no longer with us, so it's just one of those things that I just carried out for him and his family. I just love shark fishing. It's one of those things where you live to beat the beast. You know, bigger is better. You want that 14-foot plus shark on a daily.
We're out here. The weather's terrific. We got a bunch of big old fish just sitting on the bottom, waiting for some old tooth critter to come by and bite it, I guess.
Robbie and I have a couple spinning rods just right in the first trough. It's a really deep 5-foot trough.
You do have to have a saltwater fishing license to do so. There's regulations because they're trying to protect these things, so there's a course for you to get certified in order to land-based shark fish. It is free on my FWC. The course gives you the knowledge in order to first to know that you have the right gear to do so you're not harming the shark by losing rigs and just letting them eat your hooks and gut hooking them. Go online, go ahead and take the course. Come out here, 80-pound braid minimum to shark fish, target sharks. I have 100 pounds on these because I have 100 pounds of drag on these spinner reels. 100 pounds of drag.
Absolutely fascinating. Your harness.
Oh yeah, he's on there. I can feel him.
Got it.
So here we go. There we go.
Hammer, dude. Hey, we've been out here a lot lately, so long time coming. Wow. Oh boy. Holy fuck.
I'm about to get her.
Thank you.
Still do it.
$150 to $200 a year.